So joined here today by Kevin Richmond, Chief Executive of the Sussex Community Foundation. Welcome to Ladies TV, Kevin. I know you've got a lot to talk about today in terms of your organisation. Maybe just start off by talking a bit about what the Sussex Community Foundation does and when it was established and how long you've been there for as well.
Great, thanks Mark. And yeah, thank you for inviting us to be on Ladies TV. Delighted to be here. So Sussex Community Foundation has been going for 15 years. We're a charity which really supports the whole of Sussex, and our job is to raise money for and to give grants to local charities and community groups across Sussex. And what we're particularly proud of is reaching the grassroots of local communities, getting to small charities and community groups that most people don't know about but can make a massive difference with a small amount of money.
Yeah, I mean, what kind of organisations are you helping out then? You know, ones we're familiar with in the city?
Yeah, well, I mean, really, we support any charity that we can, really. We support well over 2,000 charities across Sussex. So it'll be the ones you're very familiar with, such as the Rocking Horse or the Markless Hospice in Brighton, people like Brighton Hove Food Partnership, right down to tiny organisations that people won't know about, like the Brighton Cauldron, been giving out food over the last year. The Morsgan Bangladeshi Women's Group. It's a really a vast range of groups, from the big charities to the very, very small.
Yeah.
And that's what we're about, is supporting our local communities. And the way we do that is we provide a service to people who want to give locally. So we work with companies like American Express or Gatwick Airport in normal times, and we help them to reach their local community. So there's two sides of the service. It's really working with people who've got money to give and working with charities that need help.
Yeah, I know you've set up this crisis fund. Just a quick word for organisations. They've suffered a lot during lockdown, haven't they, in terms of the funding, because obviously people can't go out and fundraise in the way that they normally would do with the kind of, you know, the marathons, the fun runs, etc. So are you seeing that on the ground as well? I mean, I'm sure you are.
Yeah, it's a massive issue, actually. I mean, we've given out a lot of money in the last year. We've raised a lot of money. Because there's been a tremendous response to the crisis, and actually a lot of people have given money by giving to the local community foundation or giving to National Emergencies Trust or the NHS charities with the Captain Tom's appeal.
Yeah.
So a lot of money was given last year, but actually a lot of that's dried up now. So while charities were able to get money for their crisis response in 2020, what they're telling us now is actually that's dried up. There isn't new funding, but still we can't fundraise yet. So that's why we're relaunching the Sussex Crisis Fund now to help charities, because we know the need is still really great.
Yeah. What's that Crisis Fund do then? Just tell us a bit about what it does and how people can apply for it if they're listening in and they might think it, you know, they kind of qualify for it.
Yeah, okay. Well, it's really what the Crisis Fund is now, so the next phase of it is really to help charities through the next phase of the need. And I think we're focusing on a number of areas where we think there's particular demand. So that's looking at mental health issues, providing advice and support, so benefits advice, debt advice, all those, helping with food, just a lot of need to help with people shopping and getting access to food, but also helping people to reconnect to society. So as the lockdown starts to ease, to start to help charities to start to bring people together again, get together and socialise again. So all of those things, if charities are doing that locally, they can just make contact with us at Sussex Community Foundation, and it's quite a simple application form, and we will make decisions on those grants pretty quickly.
Yeah. Where do you get your money from then, Sussex Community Foundation? Where's your funding come from to help others?
So in general, it comes from local people. It all comes from local people, local companies.
Yeah.
As I was saying, we provide a service to larger companies and to wealthy people, particularly to help them give locally. So in a way, a big part of our job is promoting philanthropy. So people will, it's often said maybe when someone's leaving a legacy or someone's sold a company and come into a lot of money and they want to give something back to the community, or companies that are working and, you know, making money in the community want to give back. A community foundation is a brilliant vehicle for actually helping them to reach the communities on the ground.
Yeah.
So right. In a way, our money comes from Sussex people and goes to Sussex people. You know, it's all about a community.
What about examples? You know, what last year, there are any examples of kind of charities that you helped out and kind of what the outcomes were?
Yeah, well, I think, so if we go back to a year ago when the lockdown started, we thought, right, we've got to do something about this. We knew there was going to be a massive need. So we launched the crisis fund on the 20th of March. And we put out an appeal, as we did, as we are now, for people to donate. Yeah. And we invited charities to apply to us because we knew, like, within a week of that lockdown, people were organising, especially around Brighton and Hove, people were organising to make sure no one went hungry. And we thought, okay, they need money quickly. So we raised money quickly and we gave out grants within 10 days. And last year we were giving grants every Monday afternoon. Our grants committee was meeting.
Yeah.
So we were turning grant applications around within a week. And one of the things that I thought was amazing a year ago was the work that the Brighton Hove Food Partnership did with the food banks across the city. And you know, within 10 days, they had a network of food delivery across Brighton and Hove. And that was before statutory services knew what had hit them, really. But the, you know, local charities had organised in this tremendous way. And we were able to get grants really quickly to all those groups, you know, like the Food Partnership, like the Bevy in Morscombe, like Hangers on and Known Project, St. Richard's Community Centre, Hangleton, vast range of things like that. And also organisations like Time to Talk Befriending, you know, who really vital during that period, and so many people are isolated, you know, setting up telephone support again overnight. You know, it's really the work that local charities has done over the last year, as we know, has been absolutely extraordinary. And they've shown what people can do when you work together.
Yeah, you know? Exactly. How's this crisis fund different then to the work you normally do? And how do people apply for it?
So to apply for it, you just go to our website, which is sussexgiving.org.uk.
Yeah.
And there's simple links there as part of how to apply for grants. There's an online application form. But people can also ring our grants team, which is 01273 409 440. And the grants team are always really happy to help talk people through how to apply, to give them advice about, you know, whether they're eligible or not. But this is for charities. That's the main thing on success. Yeah. It's not people, you know, asking for direct help themselves. It's actually help through charities.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, charities, they've come to the fore, really, haven't they, over the lockdown, with three lockdowns, we're just coming out of the third. They've become really important, haven't they? The kind of the work that they're doing to communities, and actually communities have been putting together. They've kind of really shone through, haven't they? That, particularly in Brighton and Hove. But I know your work stretches beyond Brighton and Hove as well, doesn't it?
Yeah, we cover the whole of Sussex, but it's absolutely the case right across the county.
Yeah.
How quickly? I mean, this is the thing. I think we all knew that charities do great things.
Yeah.
What was amazing a year ago was A, how quickly they responded, B, how strategically they thought. You know, that people weren't just thinking, well, I'll take food to a few people around my street, although people were doing that. They were saying, how do I make sure that people all across Brighton have got food? How do we make sure that everyone's got someone to talk to? You know, they're really working together in a strategic way, which I think actually, yeah, local authorities were quite in awe of to start with, but I think they've really supported that process as well.
Yeah.
So one of the other great things that's coming out of this is much stronger partnerships between local charities and the councils. And councils have also had to move much more quickly than they've ever done before. And they've really enjoyed that, I think. So everyone's thinking that was great. How do we keep on doing things without this bureaucracy getting in the way? You know, it's great.
All right, that's it for the first half. Join us for the second half. I'll be speaking a lot more to Kevin about the work of the Sussex Community Foundation. Join us then.
Remember, you can keep in touch with us on the various social media channels, Twitter and Facebook, by searching Latest TV. Plus, of course, you can see all our clips and get the latest news at our website, which is www.thelatest.co.uk. We'll see you in just a few minutes.
Back to the vote. I'm here with Kevin Richmond, and we are going to be talking a lot more about Sussex Community Foundation. Kevin, should we start off with talking a bit about the lockdown and the impact that's had on communities? Spoke a lot about to people throughout the lockdown period that mental health suffered a lot, hasn't it? People's mental health, access support for mental health services is proven a bit of a challenge. It was difficult before the first lockdown, and now we're coming at the third lockdown. It's even more difficult, if we're being honest about it. So,
yeah, absolutely. And I think that the thing that struck me most of all is, of course, the lockdown and the pandemic has just exacerbated inequality so much, hasn't it? And I've said so many times, yeah, I'm lucky. I've got a house and a garden, and my family around me. I'm not lonely. I've got plenty of work to do, and my job's doing fine. So I'm okay, but for many people, and people very close to me might be living on their own in a flat, haven't seen anyone for weeks, I've got no, social life's gone, work may have lost a job, or on furlough. It's a completely different experience. And but I think everyone now is feeling a real strain of the length of time the lockdown has gone on and the length of time the pandemic has gone on. So that's having effects for people, as you say, on mental health, on just the stress of being isolated for so long, the worry of how do you keep on paying the bills, keep on feeding the children, homeschooling, all those things. I think the pressure for so many people is enormous.
Yeah.
And it's gone on for so long that people, I think, people are feeling we've really had enough, haven't they? And I think but charities have been fantastic through that process, and communities have worked together in a way that we've never seen happen before. But what's really clear now is that the long-term impact is going to be really significant, I think.
Yeah. And
it may be just as the lockdown starts to ease that we really start to see that. And I think as people are starting to be able to go out again gradually, again, for some people whose jobs have carried on, things will be okay. Some people have got more savings than they've ever had. But what we're also seeing, and what charities are telling us, there's a lot of people who've never been in poverty before. And they're suddenly finding themselves in real debt and real problems. And they're approaching people like the Systems Advice Bureau, for debt advice. And that's a whole group of people that I think we should all be worried about.
Yeah. So have you got any examples of the work that the Sussex Community Foundation has done to support charities that have kind of helped out those people?
Yeah, so, we've been funding debt advice services right across across Sussex, Systems Advice Bureaus, Christians Against Poverty.
Yeah.
I think one of the things that has been really important is, I mentioned earlier that people like Time to Talk, Befriending, who are just giving some people someone to talk to is a really important part of the support for people. Food banks and so on, all of that's been absolutely crucial in people's lives, and we've been supporting all those charities.
Yeah, exactly. Debt advice charities, they're going to be quite important going forward. I know that you can actually map a lot of this debt privation that we see in Brighton Hove, because there are kind of pockets there, aren't there? I mean, quite close to where I am now, East Brighton's a big area with lots of debt privation. What are the tools that you've kind of developed? I know you've got kind of this You've got kind of data, haven't you, on the
communities? So the key thing is a report we publish every 3 years called Sussex Uncovered. And this is, I think, it's a really useful source of data. It's really valuable for charities and also for anyone who's interested about the community. But we use it to inform our donors about where they should be giving. So there's a document which collates loads of data about deprivation, disadvantage and health issues across the whole of Sussex. And that's also available online as a searchable database where you can look at any issues in any kind of particular area. And what that tells us a lot is you know, that while Sussex is often seen as quite a wealthy county, and Brighton's often seen as a wealthy place, there's real pockets of disadvantage right across. And like you say, parts of East Brighton, parts of Portslade, you know, Hambleton and Knoll in the city, you know, there's loads of challenges there. But you can also find in the areas where are perceived as wealthy, there are people who are really struggling.
Yeah.
It's not just about where you live, it's about what you have, isn't it? It's important.
Yeah. Yeah, exactly. And I know there's certain kind of, you know, certain groups as well, the BAME or BAME communities have been particularly affected, obviously, not just by COVID-19, but, you know, economic consequences as well. And those in retail, in the retail sector, I mean, retail sector has been kind of decimated. We don't know the full impact yet because the shops haven't quite opened back up again, but they're going to be big issues. Housing as well is going to be a big issue, particularly in Brighton, because lots of people want to live here. And obviously we don't have the housing or the accommodation to kind of, you know, for everyone to fit in.
Yeah, absolutely. And I mean, just coming back to the Black, Asian and minority ethnic communities, I think that, like you say, they have been disproportionately affected by COVID. They're often disproportionately affected by poverty as well. And I think it's the two factors together that often make things worse. And so back in the summer last year, we consulted a lot of the Black and Asian and minority ethnic groups that we knew. And we asked them what was happening for their communities. And it was really quite a stark message they gave, because whatever impact you thought people were having, they were seeing it, you know, many times over. You know, so they talked about, we talked to the Fellowship Education Society, which has which primarily works with Turkish community, and they were saying a high proportion of their community members ran their own businesses. And they were primarily kind of in retail or taxi driving, or, you know, but their business had closed down, but they weren't benefiting from furlough because they were running their own businesses. And they didn't have necessarily the language skills to access what government support there was, you know, so all the barriers were kind of exacerbated, you know. And they talked about also that they tended to live in more overcrowded housing, which meant it was even more stressful for families, you know. And the thing that really hit me most of all was some of the stories from refugees who were actually saying, you know, the whole lockdown was kind of re-traumatizing them, reminding them of the situation they'd had to escape from, you know, and facing serious barriers in terms of getting any support because of their refugee status or language status, or they couldn't get interpreters for services. So I think, I mean, it's really interesting on the day when the government's producing a report saying that you know, we're a model of integration. I mean, yeah, there's lots of things we get right, but it's really important to remember for a lot of people that's not their experience.
Exactly. That's quite important to point out. Before we finish up, how can people get involved again? Just a bit more about the Sussex Crisis Fund. I know we mentioned it in the first half, maybe in the second half. So how can charities access this fund, and what they need to do, where they need to go?
So, to access the fund and find out more about us, to go to our website, which is www.sussexgiving.org.uk. And you can also give us a ring on 01273 409 440.
Yeah.
And if people would like to donate to the Sussex Crisis Fund, then please go to our total giving site, which is www.totalgiving.co.uk, then /appeals, and then / Sussex Crisis Fund, or you can just search for the Sussex Crisis Fund.
Great. Going forward, what's it looking like for Sussex Community Foundation, you know, going forward in the next few months, now we're coming out of the lockdown? I'm guessing you're going to be going back to the office, or is this kind of remote working worked for you?
I think it's really interesting. We're having lots of discussions, actually. I think we're like most people, but I think actually one of the things that might come out of this, I think people like working from home a bit. I think probably people are getting tired of working at home all the time. So I'm expecting we'll have a mixture, actually. I think we were just talking this morning. I've been asking the team what they want to do, and most people are saying, I'd like to come in the office maybe 2 or 3 days a week, but work for home the other half of the week. And I think we'll probably try and accommodate that, because it gives people more of a work-life balance, you know?
Yeah, exactly. And I know you're normally based in Lewes, aren't you? So I guess you're doing a lot of good work in Lewes as well.
Yeah, absolutely. The office is based in Lewes, but we work right across Sussex in every town and village in Sussex. One of the other benefits of working from home is that our team are spread around Sussex. We've got people in Crawley and Hastings and Portslade and Hollingbury, and so you know, it does give us a reach and a presence across the county, which is great.
Yeah, and are there other organisations like the Sussex Community Foundation in other areas? I mean, is there, how many kind of community foundations are there, or is this quite a unique organisation?
No, there are 47 community foundations in the UK, so it's basically one for each county. Yeah. We work as a very strong network, and we learn from each other. And in fact, the National Emergencies Trust worked through community foundations last year, so they raised £100 million.
Brilliant. All right, we'll leave it there. Kevin, thanks for joining us today. All the best for the future, and with the Sussex Crisis Fund as well. Thanks for joining us today.
Thanks very much, Mark. Thank you.
Thanks.